Hi, I'm Tom Feldman, and that performance was of a tune called Spanish Fandango. And we're going to take some time to really explore the rich depths of Spanish tuning, which came from Spanish Fandango. And with us to do that is Mr. Stefan Grossman.
Hey, Tom. How you doing?
Very well. How are you?
Good, good. Well played. An interesting tune that came out, they say, originally in about 1833. And there's a dirty little secret. And we're blues guitar players. We love playing the guitar. We like to think of it as being a traditional way of playing, a homegrown way of playing
right.
guitar. But yet we have this tune, Spanish Fandango. Number one, it's played in an open G tuning.
Correct.
It was originally written down in music. And so the guitar was tuned as if it was an open G chord. But so students don't get confused. It's not as if this is the G chord and you're
right.
going to tune up those strings.
Sure.
It's as if you had an A chord, you move it down one fret, two frets. So that shows that the second, third, and fourth string is going to remain the same.
Okay.
This goes down to a D. The low E string goes down to a D. And the fifth string, the A, goes down to a G.
Right.
So the end result is... And so we have an open G tuning. The dirty little secret is that this music, which was called parlor guitar music,
right.
which was very, very popular in the northeast part of America, it was written by various, the tunes were pseudo-classical tunes written by various music teachers. One was called Henry Worrell, very
sure.
popular, and he had a guitar method. And their students, the people who were playing this music, were mostly women.
Oh, sure. Wow.
You know, middle-class white women. And he came out with a written, his arrangement of Spanish Fandango in 1866. And this piece of music somehow, and this is the dirty little secret, somehow with the playing of white and black, what we call folk traditional musicians, whether it would be Mississippi John, Hurt, Furry Lewis, Elizabeth
sure.
Cotton,
yep.
and there are many white players as well, you find this tune in their repertoire.
Right.
How? How did it get there? And whereas with the blues tradition and the white country tradition, there was so much music that was recorded during the 20s, you can follow the lineage of different styles and traditions.
Sure.
But with parlor guitar music, it was not recorded.
Right.
So this is sort of like a black hole. Did it influence the guitar playing of the traditional music musicians that we worship
right,
practically,
right.
that we want to imitate? I think the answer is yes, because
I
you find
so
the piece, Spanish Fandango, in their repertoires.
Right.
However, what happens, as America was going westward, Sears and Roebuck and other companies, they started to have what would be considered today like Amazon.com, mail order companies, and they were selling all types of things, tents, pots and pans, whatever you needed, auto harps, banjos, guitars.
Sure.
And those guitars that were being shipped out, and they were not expensive guitars,
right.
they would have a booklet in, you know, what tunes
oh, sure,
to play,
yeah.
you know?
Yep.
And one of the tunes happened to be Spanish Fandango.
Ah.
So that was, you would think, one of the ways that these musicians, they would see this tune and they would start to play, but a very strange transformation happened. Whereas the original Spanish Fandango written piece of music is in 3/4 time.
Right.
Traditional musicians happen to change
it
into 4/4 time. And in fact, my friend John Renborn, he did a dissertation on parlor guitar, and he said, you know, if you take Spanish Fandango, put it in 4/4, it's like a blues.
Sure, yep.
And I think you know.
I do. I know the version that I know, in addition to that parlor guitar version, is one that was recorded in 1929 by John Dilshow. And he did it out of, whether he was tuned to open A or did a capo, I'm not too sure, but I learned it in open A, which is still Spanish tuning. It's...
Right, yeah, it's the same intervals,
the same way of playing as open G, but it's E, A, E, A, C sharp, E, And I think I'll play a little bit of that four-time version.
I think
version.
We should mention that a lot of the musicians, what's important is the intervals with the strings.
Sure.
Because when you listen to a lot of the old blues recordings, you'll see that musicians will be in a Spanish tuning, but they may be tuned high
right,
into
that's very
B
true.
Or C. Even.
Yep. So I'll play a little bit of the 4/4 time version of Spanish Fandango.
Okay. Interesting, 1929, and he was playing the guitar like that in the white camp. And in the black camp, if you want to call two sides of the track, you have someone like Mississippi John Hurt using that alternating bass style, which when I was learning guitar, still am learning guitar, Reverend Gary Davis always referred to that as where the musicians were trying to play the guitar like a piano, like a ragtime piano, and where the thumb, the bass, was playing the left hand of the piano, and he would say just the index finger, because that's all he used, just these two fingers. The index finger would be playing a melody. And of course, the person that really influenced so many generations of guitar players was Mississippi John Hurt.
Right.
1928, a year before the tune you played, he recorded this tune called Frankie. It's his arrangement. I'll just play the guitar part. And if you listen to the original recording, you can get totally confused because he's in open G, but yet he begins and it's in B. So it's as if it has a capo on the fourth fret of the guitar.
Wow. Okay.
But by the time the tune ends, he's in C.
Oh, wow.
So something happened
right.
when they were making that master. That either there was a jolt of electricity or they realized they couldn't get the whole tune into the time limit that those old 78s
okay.
had. So here's Frankie, and you'll notice there's a lot of similarities. Thank you. So that was the way Frankie was played by Mississippi John Hurt. Now, not to confuse matters further in our quest for trying to find the influences of those players that we really admire so much, the Charlie Pattons, the Willie Browns, Sunhouse, Robert Johnsons. At the turn of the last century, you had Hawaiian musicians. They toured all around the world. And in America, they came. And of course, they were playing with a steel.
The slide, yeah.
And a lot of them were playing the guitars on their lap.
Okay.
They actually toured in such distant lands as India. So that India, you have a tradition of playing ragas on specially built guitars with slides.
Okay.
Okay. So you have that influence with the ragtime piano influence. Everything is sort of like converging, and the people just living in the country, white and black, they're hearing all this music. The African, the black Americans, from their African traditions, they also had ways of playing stringed instruments with a bone.
Right, yep.
So here's a clip, this is very cool, of Bucca White, and he's playing Poor Boy Long Way From Home, which he originally recorded when he was in Parchman Farm in the jail for the Library of Congress. But he has his guitar on his lap. He just takes a rod.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
You know, and he's just playing it like this, and it almost looks like he's a Hawaiian musician, but he's playing the blues.
Right.
So here's Bucca White doing Poor Boy Long Way From Home.
Have a dime. Time of a song of grace.
that was Booker White playing Poor Boy Long Way From Home. And although he was playing on his lap, he played many different songs right side up with the guitar. And it is interesting that when they went from the lap and they turned the guitar right side up, that it is very easy to still play those bar chord with the slide. And a really great example of that is Leadbelly's version of C.C. Rider.
Right.
So I think I'll do a little performance of C.C. Rider.
Go get him. I love that arrangement of C.C. Rider. And Leadbelly, I think, is one of the most underrated guitar players, blues players, you know, of the last generations. What I think is really interesting is when you're playing in this open tuning, your whole guitar is tuned to a chord. Why don't they teach kids how to play guitar like this right from the get-go?
That would be a lot easier, wouldn't it?
Wouldn't it? Because if you notice right away, they could go, bop, bop, beep, beep, bop, 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 and their little hand fingers could go.
Absolutely.
And just fret, or you could be like Ricky Havens and do it this way. And right away they'd be playing music.
Right.
What's also I found interesting is at certain point, what makes those Delta players so, and when we say the Delta, the specific people, usually around a very specific area of the Delta. How come Son House, Charlie Patton, Willie Brown, they're playing the guitar, especially in open G, in a very particular manner, and they're not playing the guitar like it's a piano. They're playing it very percussively. So I'm going to, if you, I think what would be interesting, I'll play a little bit the way Son House taught me, just playing a blues in G. And then if you would play the same motif,
right,
but with the
Banty
slide.
Rooster is,
yep.
is similar to that idea with a slide.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So here's just a blues in G a la Son House. Thank you. So that was a little bit the way Son House taught me how to play a blues in G in Spanish tuning. One of the things that I think is interesting is the delicacy or lack of, in the terms of his attacking, which I used think was fantastic. Mm. So if he's playing, he's really making
digging in.
And digging in with those notes. That was one approach. The other approach would be to play with a slide, which you're the champion, you're the governor of slide playing. And on top of all this, I always think of Reverend Gary Davis when he would tell me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because he would say playing an open tuning is cheating and playing with a bottleneck is cheating.
So I'm the ultimate cheater.
Well, not really. And I would say to Reverend Davis, well, you can't do it. But his style is totally different. It's just so interesting. Mm-hmm. His approach was a completely different approach to how to play music on the guitar. These Delta players, they sort of start getting, number one, more rhythm, more texture. Mm. And with the slide, which I hope you can demonstrate, a tune similar to the one I played, and just to hear the difference.
Yeah, I think another song that kind of follows suits to that particular piece was Banty Rooster by Charlie Patton. So I think I'll play a little bit of Banty Rooster.
Cool. Oh, that was wonderful, beautiful. The way you control that slide, I'm jealous.
Oh, well, thank you. Very nice of you to say.
You know what I'd like to do is the next thing to show as an example was how those the Delta musicians, the Charlie Pattons, Tommy Johnson, Son House, there was a family of tunes, and most of the Delta musicians they referred to as the Maggie Campbell.
Oh, okay.
You know,
right.
Blues. And that's much more rhythmic, where one guitar is really socking it out and snapping the bass.
Oh, sure.
And after that, with a lot of strumming, how about we try, I'll pretend I'm Charlie Patton, you pretend that your Son House and you're talking to me.
Okay.
Because Son and Charlie, they had a little bit of friction sometimes. I'm going to have to capo up my guitar because you're an open A.
I'm an open A.
I'm an open G. So I'm going to capo it up. I'll do a little bit of rhythm. You do a little bit of slide.
All right, I'm game if you're game.
We're game. Thank you. What's really strange is at the same time that music like we just played was being recorded, there was a town in Mississippi called Bentona, and there was a gentleman there called Nehemiah Skip James. Now, he played most of his tunes in what's called a cross note tuning, which you know, it's where the guitar's tuned to an open E minor. But he played one tune called Special Rider Blues, which was an open G.
A very cool tune, yeah.
Very interesting. And when I first heard that, and it was an old scratchy Paramount recording, I thought, wow, that is the strangest arrangement, and yet so modern. It was recorded in 1931. And when Skip was rediscovered in 64, I asked him, I said, Skip, where did that arrangement come from? Because it's so different from your other playing in the cross note tuning. And he just looked at me as if I was some, you know, silly little kid. He said, well, all I'm doing is playing what Little Brother Montgomery was playing on the piano. And I said, oh, did Little Brother Montgomery record Special Rider Blues? He said, yeah, yeah. So I had to find a record collector, because being a guitar player, who listened to piano blues? So I found a record collector who had Little Brother Montgomery, his old Paramount recording, doing Special Rider Blues, and he was famous for his Vicksburg's blues. Mm. And I listened to it, and I thought, there's nothing in common at all.
Really?
So obviously, I sort of joke about it, that, you know, Skip went through one in one ear and out the other onto his fingertips was quite unique, which in fact, his music is very unique.
Very, yes.
This open G tuning, why it's really interesting is that, and what Skip does in this arrangement that I'll play for you, is that since you have three D notes, you can play octaves. And he uses that a lot in this tune.
Okay.
We just played with the snapping bass,
right,
the Charlie Patton motif, Tommy Johnson motif. Those are also octaves, but you're playing much more percussively. But with Skip, this becomes a melodic tool, which years later, Wes Montgomery comes along and he's playing, you know, octaves on. I doubt whether Wes Montgomery or Skip James, but Skip was quite ahead of his time, because you don't really hear that in any of the other recordings from the 30s. Mm-hmm. So you want to listen to Special Rider?
I do, very much so,
I'll
yes.
I'll try to play it for you. Here we go. Thank you.
such a cool tune and Special Rider. And then fast forwarding a few years, you have Robert Johnson, who comes along and begins to integrate things that were happening in the North and elsewhere that were more urban into Delta blues and Spanish tuning, and really started changing things up. And the song that I'm thinking of in particular is Terraplane Blues.
Right.
And that is kind of an arrangement from Petey Wheatstraw. If you listen to some of his guitar recordings, which he was predominantly a piano player, but he recorded a few guitar arrangements, and they really follow suit to what Robert Johnson took from. And then he infused the slide guitar stuff of like Son House and created his own thing that now, of course, we all know as Delta blues, but Robert Johnson style.
Right. In fact, people seem to have an idea that Delta blues is Robert Johnson.
Right. Right.
And I know you and myself, we wish they would
not think that way. Well, maybe,
you know, get back to Son House,
yes,
Charlie Patton,
yeah,
Tommy Johnson. Because Robert was a great player, and,
oh, absolutely,
and the recordings are fantastic. But it's interesting, his repertoire, isn't it? How
very interesting. Yeah, whereas standard tuning songs were really more of a urban style influence from like Lonnie Johnson.
And very much influenced from records.
Right, and records, yep.
You know, or other people's performances, whereas his open G.
Yep, his open tuning, the Spanish tuning stuff is definitely more country blues, if you want to call it that,
right,
or Delta blues influenced. And some really fantastic arrangements that he did out of Spanish tuning. So I think I'll play a little Terraplane Blues.
Go ahead and do it.
When I feel so lonesome, don't you hear me when I'm on?
Terraplane Blues by Robert Johnson. You nailed it.
Oh, thanks.
You know what's interesting, and we haven't mentioned it, and I'm sure we'll get a lot of comments from five-string banjo players.
Because, you
think so? Yep, because banjo players, one of the standard tunings for a five-string banjo is open G tuning.
Yes, you're right, yep.
So I'd be curious to hear from them about if they have thoughts of the origins, or maybe even that we've not even spoken about the banjo influencing the guitar playing, but
true.
I'm sure it did, because I know with Reverend Gary Davis, some of the tunes he plays on guitar, he also used to fingerpick or frail on the banjo.
Oh, I didn't
almost
know that.
The same arrangement. When I was young, you hadn't even been born yet, you lucky devil. When we started to get involved in guitar playing, it took me a year or two to realize that Mississippi John Hurt was playing in open G when he was playing Frankie.
Oh,
really? I had pondered and pondered trying to figure out how is he playing this out, and the only reason I was finally able to get to the end of that road was that I saw Mike Seeger. He had figured it out.
Oh.
And he said, oh, open G. And then there were Furry Lewis played, Turn Your Money Green, Casey Jones in open G tuning. There were others in open D tuning, which is Vestapool tuning,
right,
you tend to call it, which is, again, based on an old parlor, a pseudo-classical piece called Sebastopol. Mm. Sebastopol was from the Crimean War, where there was the town of Sebastopol, and it was where the Turks were against the British. And there was this piece that was very popular for the parlor guitar repertoire, and that was played in open D tuning. So for my generation, we started in standard tuning. We had drop D tuning, where we tuned the low E string down to a D. We had an open G, Spanish. We had open D, Vestapool tuning. We hadn't yet figured out that anything was being played in cross note,
okay,
a la Skip James or even Buck White. What
right.
a surprise that he played in cross note. But from there, we took, I think, the knowledge of those traditional tunings. And with our banjo playing friends who played with me, they were playing in Washington Square Park, they had hundreds of different tunings.
Wow.
So you have John Renborn, for instance, he took the open G and he just brought down this to a B flat. And now you have an open G minor.
That's really interesting.
And you get a whole different feel, and John
sure.
uses it for playing Celtic music,
okay,
slow airs, as well as dance tunes. What I'd like to try to do now is to play an arrangement of Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
Oh, sure, yeah.
And I combine it with just a blues. So I'll do a couple of verses of Just a Closer Walk with Thee. And since that tune doesn't really have verse chorus, I like to perform it as an instrumental, so I'll throw in a blues just as contrast and then go back to the theme, the church. It's sort of like going Saturday or Sunday in church and Saturday in the juke joint, you know, putting them together. But it just shows the possibilities that I've been searching for in this open G tuning, Spanish tuning. And there's guitar players in the last 40, 50 years have really been, you know, going into open G, open D, all different tunings, tapping, doing all different exciting things.
Right.
So here's Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
All right, great.
Thank you.
Well, I think that does just about everything that we can talk about Open Gene. But I bet there are a lot of people who watch this that might have more information. So I'm interested, and I presume you are as
Absolutely,
well.
Absolutely, yes.
You know, send us some emails. Just go to guitarvideos.com. And if you have any information that we haven't covered, we're sponges. We want to hear from you, and we want to gather more information. You've done a great deal in the last few years, some great lessons in Open G. The Robert Johnson lesson is incredible. Sunhouse.
Right. Patton.
Yep. And also you have a lesson just on Delta Blues from...
From Dockery Plantation. Yeah. Yep, yep.
As well, John Miller, he has some lessons. There's one that deals... One DVD deals in Spanish, the other in open detuning. So there's a lot of stuff if people are interested in pursuing this further. It's a really interesting subject. I would say that people who are just beginning to play guitar, they love to listen to open G or open D, but they're afraid to get into it. Mm. In the sense they're afraid to turn the knobs of their strings.
Right. Yeah.
So fortunately today you have digital tuners, but use your ears. You have to use your ears. It's pretty easy to get in and out of these tunings. Learn to listen, and you'll have a lot of fun. I would like to, if you're game, how about we just try to riff on some, you know, more blues, a different style than the one we played before. And let's see, I'm going to sort of, yeah, I'll play the guitar more like in the piano fashion.
Okay.
And you'd be like a
I'll
Tampa Red. Yeah, you just put the cream on top of that cake, the icing
Sounds
on top
to
of the cake. Here we go. Thanks a lot.